It's late, the day before, and the Marlborough Holden dealer team is practicing for Australia's toughest motor race, the Hardy Faroda 1000. The pit crew approach their tasks with complete determination. They know more than anyone that a single split-second mistake can cost this important endurance event.
Okay.
Each man, from driver to mechanic, is only too aware that Bathurst's Mount Panorama circuit leaves little margin for error. But this is the day before.
39 seconds, but
they are unaware now how vital this practice is.
Because Jim had his belt totally off him. Totally nothing on him.
Some members of the team, headed by chief driver Peter Brock, have been racing at Bathurst for over a decade. Brock has won the race four times, and this event is shooting for an unprecedented hat-trick. Brock feels this race will be his toughest. Other races will have far more power, and if Brock is to win, victory will come from his Commodore's superior handling, streamlining, and Australian Touring Car Championship winning reliability. Of Brock's skill, there is no doubt. However, despite their preparedness, there is still a slight air of apprehension within the team.
I don't think we get there this year, actually.
I just think we've been made to go too slow.
And there'll be a real catfight in these opening laps.
What a scrap.
I believe the Camaros were clocked at 175 yesterday, and we're getting about 156. The best Commodore, and that's, you know, I'd say no one in the world could get the thing going any better than we've got it going.
The Hardy Faroda 1000 starts several days before the Sunday flag fall. Battle is joined from the moment the transporters disgorge their sleek thoroughbred chargers. Cars not that different from showroom models. If Bathurst is many races within a race, this is the first. Many teams drive hundreds of kilometres in practice. Long experience has taught the Marlborough Holden dealer team to keep their cars as fresh as possible, and they spend little time on the track during the first sessions. Last minute adjustments. Everything has to be just right.
Whichever ratio we decide on, put in tomorrow and between the sessions. I don't think you'll have any problems.
Actually,
we don't do that until tomorrow, this is checking the radio gear.
And while the mechanics ready the machines, the opposition is showing its hand with early fast times, and the watching Brock is left in no doubt that the Camaro of Bartlett and the Ford of Johnson will be the cars to beat.
It's a very quick car down the straight. Well over, well, it's just over 170 miles an hour, and it feels like it's well over.
How do you think you look for pole?
Pretty good.
Will Dick Johnson worry you?
Oh yeah, Dick's a worry. Don't forget Gricey, don't forget Bobby Morris, don't forget Brock even.
The guy that I'm worried about more than anyone would be Peter Brock. Because he's...
Well, he's saying he's worried about you.
Well, the feeling's mutual.
The feeling's mutual. A friendly, surface remark. But underscoring the deep-seated tension among the rivals as the pace of the sessions begins to accelerate. There is no room for mistakes. Only the 10 fastest cars will run for pole, the coveted number one start position. In many ways, it's a tiring business. The cars are in and out of the pits constantly. But the reward is knowing that Brock is within striking distance of the front row. Whether he gets there or not is a different matter, although his chief mechanic has few doubts.
Oh, they're running fairly well, Liz. No problems at all.
How's Brock's car?
Car, excellent. Yeah, running better than yesterday, actually.
Even this early?
Yeah.
And what about Harvey?
Harvey's real happy.
Well, how does pole look?
Oh, it's possible, but I don't know if we can quite get there. We'll give it a fair shake.
It's called Hardy's Heroes, the culmination of the trials as the fast men, and some not so fast, strive for a high slot on the grid. At stake is the enormous prestige and tactical advantage of the number one spot. So it gets underway. The official pole session is a tense affair, and although Brock's time is extremely quick for a down-on-power car, he's disappointed.
Turned into hard to oversteer, ran across the dirt on the inside of the corner, and went up over, you know where Dickie Johnson hits the wall every year? Just went straight up there, past this sideways, it was excellent.
Have a look at the
front.
But
very slow.
The battle is now joined in earnest.
Pole position, still unresolved. Johnson has just fixed up everybody. 221.1.
No, Dick Johnson has done a flyer.
Yeah, well, Dick's 21.5, yeah, 0.7 better than Peter, and I can't say I'm surprised.
We've had 13 poles in succession, and in fact, we've never had anything else but pole and position in this car to this date, so I would like to keep it intact, but that number 13...
Brock tries again. Each of the top 10 gets two runs against the clock.
Good enough. 221.81. On the second row of the grid, not pole position, not even the outside of the front row. Brock is third fastest for Bathurst, 1980. Kevin Bartlett, he has to beat a time of 221.11, and can he beat it? The Brock Richards car...
The Marlborough car has developed a slight electrical problem, so slight that it's holding Brock up by a bare second. But a second is a second, and Bartlett and Johnson are gaining the upper hand.
Well, out goes the tail, charging up towards the start-finish line, and we're looking for a good time here from KB, because he was flying then, 220.97 for Kevin Bartlett, and that's pole position for Bathurst 1980.
There for a while, but I feel like I sort of stopped. Dick's just having a go now, let's just see, huh?
Same. There could be a change of play in here, I think.
Oh, yeah, okay. He hasn't done it, so the pole position will have to stand at Bartlett, and Johnson will have to content himself with the outside of the front row.
So Bartlett gets the glory of pole. On race day, it's more a question of who'll last the distance.
Well, we've predicted it all the way along that big cars have got the horsepower, and we haven't. And that's probably where they'd finish up on the grid.
Bruce, as the chief mechanic, who's obviously had a big hand in preparing the cars for this race, we know the drivers are nervous, but what would you be feeling?
Well, I'm not very nervous, Lev. I was more nervous yesterday when we had all those problems with the car. We just seem to have sorted them out now and everything.
Finally, it's time to go.
Peter Brock, the man who has won here four times in all, a record he shares with Alan Moffat further back on the grid.
The reigning Australian Touring Car champion, the man who had pole here last year and who won the race last year, who led throughout last year. Not used to being where he is at the moment. Going to be looking to turn the tables on the pair that have taken the top spots on the grid away from him.
The count is out 10 seconds.
In seconds, the great race will begin. A race few will survive.
And it's Johnson who's got the start, and it's a slow start by Kevin Bartlett with a Camaro, and cars are peeling around.
As the cars begin their first lap, a sign of things to come. Bartlett, the pole winner, has made a poor start, and although he will claw his way back to second, the equilibrium of his race has been upset. Worse will follow.
Well, that shows the length of the Camaro. He made up a lot of ground and passed three cars going up there.
In a furious swirl of noise and colour, it's all Johnson and his Ford.
Rocket last lap.
Brock has forced his way into second, but whether he can hang on to it is another matter.
Top of the mountain on lap one. Oil already appearing, whistling around the back.
Signs of more trouble, and the race is hardly a lap old.
Dick Johnson, who leads from Peter Brock.
These are anxious moments for Cruz, If their chargers can get through the stress of these first laps, there's every chance they'll stay the distance.
Kevin Butler, followed by Alan Grice, John Harvey.
But there are a few hard and fast rules in motor racing, and there are always exceptions.
Bobby Morris is the next one.
The smoke is pouring from the stricken car of four times Bathurst winner Alan Moffat. As he slows, the leaders continue their battle, oblivious to his fate. As Johnson consolidates his first position, Moffat can only reflect on the fortunes of the sport. One day a winner, the next a lonely and dejected loser. Within minutes, Brock and fellow Commodore driver Alan Grice are battling for second as Butler takes his brakeless Camaro into the pits. Brock and Grice have no time to reflect on the misfortunes of others. Their struggle for second is a fierce affair, even if they are slowly losing ground to Johnson, who is pushing hard, anxious to take advantage of Butler's protracted pit stop. The hardy Barodo is no respecter of reputation. Misfortune can strike at any time, and Bartlett is not the only one to have his carefully laid strategies disintegrate. Bartlett finally gets back on the track as yet another drama begins to unfold.
Well, what depends on other people.
Now, the steering's all right. Yeah, check the spoiler.
No, it's not over. Brock, from second place to nowhere in seconds. The misfortune which usually strikes at others has involved him in a collision, and his unexpected pit stop throws his carefully planned race into momentary confusion. Brock is furious, anxious to get back into the race. Each second lost now is a disaster of great magnitude. Johnson is close to lapping the Marlborough car. The situation is potentially disastrous. It's been a bad stop. There can never be enough practice for this sort of thing. Johnson, having just lapped Brock, powers on. The Marlborough driver, within seconds, will witness an incredible change of fortune as the lead car crashes heavily and quits the race in a welter of shattered metal and hopes. In the pits, the Marlborough mechanics are faintly aware of the drama. However, they're more worried about the Commodore. Will it be able to make up ground?
You obviously weren't ready for him.
No, we weren't ready for him. We'd lost radio contact with him coming down the Conrod and couldn't understand what he wanted to tell us. It was a bit of a surprise.
The Marlborough car's position is a brutal reminder of the unpredictability of motor racing. From second to eighth, a lap down, and to all intents and purposes, out of the race. But if Brock's misfortune has been dramatic, his problems are light compared to the blows which have fallen on Johnson. The shattered wreck bears testimony to the savagery of the accident. The unfortunate Johnson has gone from first to nowhere. The lead Marlborough driver, now running at full race speed, has begun the long fight back. He soon gets back on the same lap, driving furiously, unaware of the drama unfolding in the pits.
And what, then he hit the truck?
No, he didn't hit the truck.
Oh, that just sent it over to PA.
No, the rock, he hit the rock first.
there's nothing I could do because there was a pickup truck on the left hand side going up the hill. I couldn't go around that way. I had to try and go down the other way, and there wasn't enough room. I unfortunately hit it with the left hand and front wheel and the left hand rear wheel, and just ripped the wheels off the car and I hit the fence.
For 30 laps, Grice has led the race. But in a brilliant drive, Brock has slowly whittled the margin down to almost nothing. The Marlborough pit can scarcely believe it. Neither can Grice's team manager. As Brock swoops into the lead, Bathurst has seen a great drive from a real champion. From out of contention to race leader. The first scheduled stops by the front runners now start. John Harvey in the number 2 Marlborough car has run much of the first session in third position. In taking on fresh tyres, a tank full of fuel and a new driver, the car will drop several positions, but climb back later as the other leaders make their stops. Harvey, the faithful backup, has done his job well. He knows his car is well positioned for a high placing. Grice is soon in. He will lose his second and drop several places as well. Brock is now well ahead and drawing away. Grice elects to stay in the car. While out on the track, the Jansen Perkins Commodore is starting to enter calculations. Grice goes out. After the tenseness and uncertainty of the unscheduled stop, the Marlborough Holden dealer team pit is determined that Brock's second visit to the pit will go like clockwork. As he rushes in, the only car raising any immediate threat is the second Marlborough machine. And as Brock quits his Commodore, he is undeterred at the thought of losing his hard-fought lead. Better a teammate than someone else. Brock is exhausted. The man has just driven the stint of his life, taking his car from a position of absolute disaster to that of potential winner.
No, it's just simply a matter of a slower car initially giving me the correct pass line through the corner, and as I closed the gap, he moved across and closed that and waved me around the outside, and I was just unfortunately committed, so I jumped on the brakes and didn't hit him very hard, actually, although it skewed him offside and he hit the tyre barrier and did a nice gentle roll. I just sort of put it to second gear and had a bit of a feel and headed for the pits to have a bit of a look-see. At the last part of that session there, I was doing lapping many laps in 2 minutes 22. In fact, I had to leave and I came back in, so I had to make up 2 minutes on
Grice comes in again. He's been slowly losing ground and will slip to fifth on the driver change. While Brock feels Grice is no longer a threat, he knows there's ample time for more drama, as if there hasn't been enough already. So it goes, slowly edging past halfway, and to the team which thought its race was finished, the end is now in sight. The chance of victory no longer so remote.
It's looking pretty good. The car seems to be going okay. Certainly the problem stabilised early on. I was a little bit concerned, but all was lost there a while back, but we've come good.
Did you get the feeling you had a pretty narrow squeak?
My word, yes, very narrow squeak indeed, Les. This is Bathurst place. Honestly, you can't afford to make too many mistakes like that, and normally when you do make a mistake like that, it's the end of the day for you.
As co-driver Ron Harrop leaves the car for Harvey, he's not to know that the machine is about to fail, leaving the race to an unchallenged Brock and partner Jim Richards. Harrop cannot know if the second Marlborough car will falter without warning. Car number 05 fastens relentlessly onto first as Brock waits to take over from Richards. Harvey and his car make an unhappy entrance to the pits. Many others have gone the same way, but this hardly compensates for the disappointment of retirement. Richards is in quickly. There's no real danger, Grice and Jansen, squabbling over second, are well behind and no threat. Despite the large gap to second, Brock is determined to keep the pressure on. And while Harvey and the mechanics ruefully ponder the fate of the second Marlborough car, the Grice entry effectively quits the race when it runs off the track and mires in sand.
All our chances of slipping away, the thing's run on the pace all day. I know it's a driver error.
Grice is mortified. Brock is now totally beyond reach, and the man who led for 30 laps is headed for a lowly placing. Jansen's second place is now secure.
Ian, that spin by Grice's co-driver must have taken a lot of the pressure off Peter Jansen.
Yes, it has, Liz. We were 20 seconds in front of him at that stage, and we were hoping to get a bit of a...
He's just in again now.
He's just in again now. I think he lost about a couple of laps down there in the sand.
Grice's co-driver is horrified at his mistake. But it can happen to anyone. There's little chance of a similar mishap befalling Brock. He's driving too well, knowing that his fifth Hardy Ferodo win is now well within his grasp. Jansen and co-driver Perkins are resigned to the obvious. Brock is simply uncatchable.
We're now lapping a bit slower than we can do, but there's no hope that we can catch Brocky unless he has a mishap, and there's no way anyone's going to catch us, so in effect we're trying to coast home now.
The last minute dramas fall everywhere but on Brock. Bartlett has again run out of brakes and crashed into a smaller car at the top of the circuit. Brock, his driving schedule's upset by the early accident, has exceeded his allowable time in the cockpit, and for the first time at Bathurst, will watch one of his wins from the sidelines. This Hardy Ferodo win has been a classic sporting feat for Peter Brock and his co-driver Jim Richards. From a position of despair, when other teams might have conceded defeat, they have fought back to a resounding victory, a brilliant achievement. Richards, the Marlborough Holden dealer team and their Commodore have no peers at Bathurst. They did it the hard way, but they did it well.
It's a long, hard day, isn't it?
It's the hardest day we've put in for a long time.
Well, it seemed as though there was a moment there when it had all gone bad, didn't it?
Yeah, it really did. When that car came in with the front of it, I thought that was it, mate.
Well, things have changed since you were past 5 minutes, Peter Brock.
Yes, we had a very, very tough battle today. It's an absolute credit to the guys behind the scenes, the way that they've prepared the cars and got them out there to get the results. And my thanks to Noel Richards for managing the team,
Bruce Nowacki, the chief mechanic for building us mighty cars, along with Neil Barnes, Andy Bartley, Greg Bennett, and Graham Brown. They've certainly delivered the goods.